It boils down to two questions. The first is multiplying harder than adding? So then the second question is why? And this is at the heart of what complexity theory is. It asks, how difficult are problems? How hard are they? Can you define what that means? And really, how many steps does it take to get to an answer?
Okay, so I'm going to play a game with you. And the way this game works is as follows. As you can see, I have a basket in front of me. And next to me, I have different types of fruits. Some of them I might have multiple of. And what I'm going to do is, at every time step, I'm going to either pull out a fruit and then show it to you and put it in the basket, or I'm going to reach in the basket and pull a fruit out and show you what I pulled out. And when I say query, what I want you to do is I want you to tell me at least one type of fruit that's still in the basket. You don't have to know everything that's in the basket, but just tell me one. So first I'm going to take a grapefruit and put the grapefruit in the basket. Then I'm going to take a pomegranate and put that pomegranate in the basket. A pear, another pomegranate, a plum. Then I'm going to take a fruit out. I'm going to take a pomegranate out and put in a grape. And I'll take out another pomegranate and put in a prickly pear, a lime, dragon fruit, pineapple, and a cantaloupe. Now I'm going to take out a pear, a pineapple, a prickly pear, cantaloupe, dragon fruit, grapefruit. So query, now you have to tell me at least one fruit that's still in this basket.
Okay, good, query. No, not grape, sorry. Any other guesses? I think people are just randomly guessing, right? but I haven't heard. And actually, there are actually two fruits that are still in this basket. So like, it's not just one thing that works out here. What? No, not tangerine. Nope. Okay, so there's one plum left and one lime.
One plum and one lime. So you may have gotten the answer right and said either plum or lime. Most of my friends who I play this game with weren't able to solve this problem because provably there is no deterministic method using less memory than remembering everything. A deterministic method is a method that doesn't make use of any randomness. A randomized method would be one where I do use randomness to guide my method, okay? And what do I mean by that? The way you're going to choose what to remember and what to forget is going to be guided by the outcomes of a random process. So you're going to say, okay, Jelani, now that you've put papaya in, let me take these 6 coins I have on the table and flip them each. There are 2 possibilities for the first coin, 2 for the second, etc. So there are 2 to the 6th power number of possibilities here. There are 64 possibilities for these coins. And based on which of those 64 outcomes happens, I'm going to use that to guide how to choose what to remember and what not to remember now that I've just put this papaya in the basket. So that's a randomized approach. And it turns out that there in fact is a randomized method for this fruit game that does better than remembering everything, that does better than deterministic methods. And what you can also prove mathematically is that the best randomized method we have for this fruit game is in fact the best method. That's what we call lower bounds, proving a lower bound on how much memory you need to be able to play this game and win.
So in the game with Jelani, we realized that being randomized can actually help us in solving a problem which otherwise seems hard. So this leads us to the notion of studying randomness as a resource. Now, normally when we think about computing, we say how much time is this computation going to take? We ask how much memory we're going to use. But for mathematical reasons and the reason that randomness is turning out to be such a useful mechanism to help us solve problems, we also now started associating randomness as a fundamental resource along with time and memory.
So suppose you find yourself in the middle of a maze and you want to get out. One thing you could try would be a deterministic algorithm for getting out of the maze. So, for example, you could try to remember everywhere you've been as you're going along through the maze, and at each junction, you'd go to one of the branches that you've never been to before. But in order to execute this to get out of the maze, you'd have to remember the entire maze and every place you've been, which if the maze is big enough, you couldn't keep in your head. So the question is, can you get out of the maze without remembering the entire portion of the maze and where you've been? And it turns out with randomization, with random algorithms, you can do exactly that. And the algorithm is extremely simple. At every time you have a choice to make about where to go, you flip a coin. And you just go in the direction that the coin suggests that you go. We've known since the 1970s that you will not only explore new portions of the maze, but you'll actually get out of the maze in a reasonable amount of time. After that algorithm was known, it was an open question in computational complexity whether one could get out of the maze deterministically by remembering very little of the maze. And 25 years later, such a method was eventually shown, a deterministic method that remembered only the equivalent of a few spots in the maze. But the algorithm is extremely complicated, something that no human would be able to do, much more complicated than this simple randomized algorithm. And in fact, it turns out to be slower than the randomized algorithm at solving the problem, too.
Essentially exploring a landscape, trying to find a path to a specific location, for example, a peak. We begin by using well-established techniques, following well-trodden paths to try and reach our destination. There are lots of different paths that we could take, and some of those paths lead to dead ends. When we're proving a lower bound, we're showing that it's impossible to reach our destination with the tools in hand. Sometimes when we're trying to prove a lower bound, that is, trying to show that a particular path leads to a dead end, instead we find that there is a hidden path that we didn't know about, and that in fact can lead to a solution that is in fact innovative and surprising.
Would like to study how much time, let's say, or any other resource are required to solve any given problem. So let's take a very simple example. We know when we try to multiply numbers, it's somehow a little harder as a task than when we try to add numbers. I can add 10-digit numbers in my head and give you the answer. I cannot multiply to 10-digit numbers in my head and give you the answer. We would like to convert this belief that we have about the inherent complexity, the hardness of this problem, into a lower bound, saying, oh, every algorithm that multiplies two numbers which are both n digits long will take much more than n amounts of time. And the natural algorithm that we can think of actually takes n square steps. We write down the product of the first digit multiplied with the number, and then the second digit multiplied with the number, and so on. We write lots of numbers together, roughly two n-digit numbers. We will write n-squared intermediate digits before we start producing the answer. Now, we might want to say that this n-squared is the right lower bound. Unfortunately, this is false, and this is one of the fundamental challenges in dealing with algorithms. The first algorithm that you deal with, that you come up with for solving a problem, might not be the best. In the case of multiplication, this algorithm that we have known from our elementary school days is not the best. There is much faster algorithms out there. They do not run in time n squared. Their running time is really much, much, much closer to the time it takes to add two n digit numbers. But it is still somewhat larger. So one challenge in dealing with algorithms is that they can be very devious, they can be very tricky, they can be very clever. And we have to deal not with the first algorithm that we think about, but all the algorithms in the world. Proving lower bounds against them is turning out to be very challenging. And we are very much in our infancy. For instance, to this date, we do not know that multiplication is a harder problem in this sense than addition.
So there are deep connections between lower bounds and upper bounds. Oftentimes, you can say they're kind of two sides of the same coin. But lower bounds are what interest me most. They talk about impossibility, that something really needs a certain amount of time before you can know the answer. And this isn't just about incremental speedups or whether you can optimize here or just get a tiny bit faster there. To me, these are talking about qualitative differences. If you can say a problem takes an exponential number of steps before you reach the answer, you can say something like, you won't know the answer until the sun engulfs the earth. So complexity theory, lower bounds really, talks about what is knowable within our lifetimes.
Computation and computational processes underlie everything that's going on in nature, in biology and in physics. At the lowest level, there are computations going on, and there are fundamental laws about how these operate. There are limits to what is possible for computations to do. And so the study of lower bounds in computational complexity, like many other things in mathematics, is really about the fundamental laws of the universe.